Okay, I ended up losing a whole bunch of footage. I have no idea where I put it. But where I left off, I think, was right before I did the choke, I needed to put one of these brackets on. I forget which one. I think it was this one, and the screw actually bound up in the threads and broke. And so I ended up having to drill out that hole and put new threads in. It seems to have worked. So hopefully I didn't get any metal filings in the carburetor, but at this point, I need to do the choke. I have the footage I lost was mostly removing, disassembling, cleaning, reassembling the choke. So I'm gonna do that now. The choke's all clean, but I'm gonna go ahead and remove it and open it up and stuff anyway. So let's see. What's the best way to do this? Okay, there's a, I don't know if you could see it, but there's a linkage. Let me get something to point with. There's a linkage that goes from here to here on this throttle linkage, and that needs to be disconnected. Now, this bit right up in here is spring loaded. There's a little spring in there, so it's a lot easier to disconnect this one. I'm not sure what the purpose of the spring is, but it's got to be to hold the little linkage arm in place somehow. So I'm gonna undo this so I don't have to worry about the spring-loaded one. Let's see. So just pull that little pin out. And washer. Okay, and then this fellow should, oh, there's another washer on the in the back here, so don't lose that. But this, I think, once it's loosened up or once it's disconnected, the choke needs to start moving around before that'll come free. So we can ignore that for now. Just remember there's a little washer right there. But next is a linkage up at the top. A couple linkages, actually. So we need to undo this linkage here from this assembly there, and then we need to undo this linkage here, and it doesn't really matter whether we do undo it here or here. So I'm just going to pull that one off. And this has a little plastic bushing in there, so it's fine. You don't have to worry about washers, but that doesn't want to quite come off either yet. So I'm gonna do this one next. So that has It has one of these cotter pins instead of the spring clips there, so. But that's okay. I should probably replace this. It's been bent a few times already. Ah, there we go. Oh. And, I don't know, this guy has a washer, even though there's a little plastic bushing, but. So, I guess we'll just put that back later. So, those are the three linkages that should free this up. So, now we have two screws. Back in here. There's one. There we go. There's the other. Okay. And that's all that's holding the choke on. So, now that it's loose, now that it's loose, this linkage has already come off, and this linkage was already loose, so now we just need to fiddle around with this linkage. So now that we got some wiggle room, it should hopefully come off. Oh yeah, we're gonna have to turn. There's a tab right here. I'm gonna have to figure that out. So, okay. I think I got that out of the way. If I can just get that just a little bit further, should pop right out. There we go, that's a little better yet. Come on. It's really close. There we go, I got it out. Okay, excellent. Oh, and there's that washer I was talking about. Okay, so that is the removal of the electric choke from the carburetor. So we'll set the carburetor over to the side. Okay, so here's this guy. Now I didn't soak this fellow because he's got some plastic bits that don't, I mean, the only way to get that out would be to disassemble this linkage, but if you do that, you know, there's a little adjustment here and things like that, and so it's probably in my opinion, it's best to leave this be. But here we have the the electrical portion that can come off. Now, depending on your model of carburetor, this may be riveted, and you may have to drill out the rivets in order to get this off. Also, some carburetors come with a little protective plate over this bit of linkage here, and this bit of linkage here, and that is also riveted, and you have to drill out those rivets. And there are different ways that this might be secured on the, that this plastic cover might be secured here. So in this case, there's some of these kind of springy clips with a just a screw. So I've got three of those. In the past, what I've done is rather than put new rivets in, I've tapped the holes and then found some metric screws to put in so that I don't have to be drilling out rivets ever again. But this is still loose because I never finished tightening it down from the last time I tried to video this. But yeah, three screws and the cover comes off. Now, be careful when you take the cover off. There's parts in there that might come loose. So you've got a bit of a spring-loaded sort of a thermocouple thing here. And in this little loop on the end, there's a plastic bit, okay? And that plastic bit fits in that loop, and you see there's a little indentation in there, and that, oops, that fits on this tab here. And so, yeah, you don't want to lose this piece because that keeps these things all tight and precise, and it gets really sloppy if you lose this piece. The other thing that you might find, mine doesn't have it, but there's like a little piece with teeth on it that helps you adjust it and then keeps it from getting maladjusted for whatever reason. This particular one doesn't have it, but I've seen some that do. And so you just make sure you don't lose that piece if you have it. This fellow is the electric part of the choke, and as far as I know, it's mainly just sort of a timer, or something that all it does is you get 12 volts in through these wires here, right? And what it does is it heats up this coil. That's all it is just a little heating element. And as it heats up, it changes shape, right? And that changing shape causes this guy to move back and forth, okay? Which causes this little mechanism to move back and forth, which in turn, changes how all these little bits interact. Okay, so, so that's all this does. And to test this, all you need to do is find out if there's continuity. If there's continuity, then it's fine. So we'll do a quick, I don't know if I put this in a surviving video, but we'll do a continuity test here. Comes on it and see what happens. I believe the white is negative. It probably doesn't matter. I do need to be able to get. So, like, yeah, okay, so there's no ohms there. Okay, so there's like almost no ohms there, right? So basically, there's continuity, therefore it's good. So that's all we need to test that, so we know that's good. Okay. So there's a little weather gasket here. And then this particular model has this assembly here. I forget what it's called now, but not all the chokes have this, but some do. And so I'm going to go ahead and take this apart. Hopefully without these screws are getting old and the heads are starting to round a little bit. So if you get a well-rounded head on your screws, it's probably a good idea to replace them. That would be a good one to replace. I'm going to actually look for a replacement for that. The other two seem okay though. Okay, and then this fellow comes off. Right. Oh, and then you got a spring right there, and then you have a diaphragm with kind of a notched rod coming out of it. So that fits in there, and this is keyed. So you see there's a little notch right there. And on this guy, there's a little tab right there. And the other thing is make sure this notch is facing out when you put it in. So then it's no problem. So at this point, you can clean this up. Here's another little plastic piece. So, I would not recommend putting this into specific carb cleaners because, there's some plastic and there's some plastic and there's some plastic in there. And so I would recommend cleaning this in some kind of plastic-friendly cleaner like Pine-Sol or maybe gasoline, but I wouldn't put it in like Chem Dip or Marine Clean or anything like that. Anything that attacks plastic that might attack plastic, I'd avoid that. So you can see I've already cleaned this up. This was full of just aluminum oxide and stuff, and I just cleaned it up already, so no big deal. These sometimes come with rebuild kits and sometimes they don't. Fortunately, I do have a brand new one here, so that's good. And then you can clean up the spring if it's dirty, clean this guy up if it's dirty. This is all just air, so there's no fuel going through any of these, so and then if you have a new gasket, might as well replace the gasket. This one's new. And let me see if I can find a replacement screw for this guy. Here's some I think would do perfect. Okay, yeah, let's get let's see. Where did I see that one guy? Oh, he's kind of mangled, so no, not him. These guys are all too short. What about this guy? Oh, he's kind of mangled too. I need to get some replacement screws, I think. Okay, this guy will be okay. He's in better shape than this one anyway. Yeah, it's too short. Yeah, let's use this guy. I'm gonna use this guy. And I still keep the crappy, you know, mangled ones for reference. So I can go to the hardware store sometime and replace them if I need to. Hopefully I won't be rebuilding any more carburetors anytime soon, so or at least this one. I won't be rebuilding any more Honda Civic carburetors anytime soon, because I'm hoping that this one will work and then my car will run. So we'll see. Yeah, so we got the little key in there, or the little tab right there, and then we got the spring and the cover, which points outward, or away from the, it points this direction, see? So, and you can kind of tell. Some of these have, sometimes there's a little bracket that sticks out for the wire, for the wiring. It's missing on this one, but if you have one, it's kind of handy to hold on to it and put it back, because then you have a little, you know, a way to keep kind of control the wiring, keep it from flopping all over the place. Kind of wish I had a bracket. I probably have a spare one that I could steal off another carburetor, but for now, I really want to get this done so I can get my car running, so I'm not going to look for it. And these don't have to be super tight. This is aluminum. I'm sure I've said that before, but I always, you know, I'm saying it have to remind myself anyway, so. So, yep, everything's moving in there good. So, gasket goes on. Well, we'll do that in a minute. Actually, let's see, we'll get that washer ready, because we'll need him fairly quickly. I'm going to leave the cover off, the electric cover off for the moment. And I'm going to pop this guy back on the carburetor. So the hardest linkage to get on here is that guy. So we'll start with him. That guy needs to go up, out of the way. Oops, get out of the light so you can see. Okay. Try to get that guy straight, and you know what I've already done? I've already made a mistake. Gotta put that washer on first, so it sits down here on top of that little tab. So there you go. Alright. So I'll try to get there we go. Ooh, look at that. Popped right on there. Excellent. Well, now I'm going to see if I can line this up with the two screw holes without breaking anything. There we go. And before I tighten that down, I want to make sure this little guy sits, or gets into his spot here. Okay. Yep, okay. Plenty of room here. Move that out of the way. I can't remember. One of these had a... excuse me. Some of these had washers on them. I'm going to put a washer on this so that the cutter pin doesn't... washer's kind of too big, but it'll work. Maybe. Anyway, I'm going to put this washer on here so that the cotter pin doesn't rub up against the plastic bushing. There you are. And, you know, wear on it. I don't know if it would. But, there we go. And then we'll just shove this little cotter pin through. There we are. Give it a twist so it doesn't come back out. Okay. Ouch. There we go. Yeah, I'll go ahead and bend that one too. There we are. So that moves just fine. Okay, and then that one fits on there. You know, I don't think there's any room for a washer. That's a tight fit right there, so I think I'm just going to put a little spring clip on there. Okay. I think the hole's right there. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, that's kind of a tight fit. So, well, alright. So now we got the linkages all put back together. So, time to tighten this guy down. Put those two screws, make sure that's sitting flush. There's a little tab that sits, yeah, right in there. Yeah, okay. So, put the two screws in. One of these screws is a little bent. I'm not sure. Well, I seem to have picked the perfect time to do this. My family is making all sorts of noise today. Oh well. Can't be helped. Gotta get this done. Okay, get those snug. There we go. Alright, now we come to, before I forget, let's get that last linkage done. Okay, so I'm going to put a little washer on there and a spring clip. Let's see if I can get it in. Can I get it through there? Yeah, not quite. Oops. I'm gonna get it from an angle here. There we go. Excellent. Okay, so that bottom linkage is secure. The two top ones are secure. Okay, everything moves nice and easy, so didn't mess anything up. Yeah, look at that. Perfect. So anyway, now we get to why I didn't put the cover on yet. And the reason I did that is because the cover rotates, has the ability to rotate. And that is how you adjust the electric choke. So I'm going to put this little plastic tab or plastic spacer onto that tab, and then I'm going to line up. I'm going to put the little round end here over that. Okay. Oops. And then I'm going to undo it because, you know what I forgot? Gasket. So now I'm going to put the gasket on. And then do the exact same thing. For real this time. First time was just practice, right? I was just seeing if you guys were watching, paying attention. Okay. Did I get that on there? I gotta make sure you actually get that on there. There we go. Okay. So, now that we have that on there, if you look close, I don't know if you can see it, but there is a little notch right there, and then there's another notch on this guy. And those generally line up. That's kind of the default location of this guy. So you notice when the spring, that thermocouple spring, was all nice and relaxed, the position was way over here. And I'm moving it way over here, several degrees over here, so that it lines up. And while it does that, you can watch this butterfly valve close. See, when it's loose, like that, butterfly valve is kind of open-ish. And as I tighten that, or as I close that up, the butterfly valve closes too. Because right now, the carburetor is... carburetor is like self-adjusting for the engine running cold. You know, the way all the mechanisms are sitting, it's doing its cold phase or whatever adjustment, and so that's what we'll adjust it for, is for when the engine is cold and hasn't been started yet. So I'll put these three screws on loosely. So I'm thinking to start with this default position, I think I'm going to start with that, because that's a nice, you know, that's a nice closed valve right there. There's one last adjustment, and I'm not sure how I will be able to show you this, because it's not really working right on this carburetor, but right here underneath the little accelerator pump, the little accelerator fuel pump here, right, that is responsible for, you know, opening up this power valve, I think. Okay, well, at the end of this arm here, there's a tab. If you can see it right there, there's a tab. Hopefully you're in frame. But there's a tab here. Now, this is supposed to be something like 11 millimeters from this bracket to this tab. And this bracket is supposed to serve as a stop. So when this, see if I can move this. When this all turns, right, this guy's supposed to stop on this bracket. And as you can see, mine doesn't go that far. I don't know if it's because this bracket is bent or what's going on, but let me double check the instructions here. I believe it is 11 millimeters. Pump lever, 12, okay, 11.9. So you can see 11.9, the pump lever for basically all the different years here is all 11.9. 82, 81, 80, Civics, Preludes, millimeters, but it doesn't stop. It's supposed to stop, I don't know, maybe that's because it's got some aftermarket parts in there, but you can see the lever stops. You know, even though the linkage keeps going and the spring is compressing, well, once it hits this, that's supposed to be what's happening already. It's supposed to limit how far open that pump goes. Now, if it doesn't open, I know that you have like a dead spot somewhere at the top of somewhere between when the primary is fully open, but right before the secondary starts to open, there's a dead spot. I think this mechanism here, this guy, all this stuff over here is supposed to prevent that dead spot. So if this doesn't open at all, you get that dead spot. I don't know what happens if it opens too much. Anyway, this, for some reason, I can move it, yeah, right about there, we have a self-limiting of about 2 millimeters or so, maybe 3, depending, well, yeah. I wonder if this bracket has been bent before, and it's just too far away. But yeah, I don't know. I do know that this carburetor worked more or less perfectly on my car for 15 years before I removed it and tried to put the original back on. 71. Oh, I wrote down a little two turns out maybe. And then the other one is on the, yep, there it is, 1 3/4, okay. Cool, I did write it down, I just didn't, I forgot where. So if you're adjusting the auxiliary and it's not a plug, it's actually adjustment screw, the default is 1 3/4. And then, you know, good luck from there, because there's no way that I am aware of to adjust that other than trial and error for this guy. And then for this guy, the primary fuel air adjustment right here, I've got it marked at 2 turns out. So let me get back to that. That's number 7. Mark position, turn until lightly seated, counting the number of turns. Turn out to the index marker and record the number of turns for pre-assembly. However, if missed recording, start with the basic for 57, back out 3 1/4, and for 71, back out 2 turns. Do not replace the limiter cap at this time. Well, I don't have one anyway. Okay. There we go. Okay. And then I'm going to turn it two turns out. So, 1, 2, 2 turns out. And then from there, well, we'll just have to fiddle around with it and see. That's going to have to be something that you adjust after you've got it on the car and you've got it running. The floats you can adjust. You shouldn't have to adjust the floats if you've adjusted them with the carburetor open. You shouldn't have to readjust them once you put it on the car. But if you do, there's a procedure for that, and I got to reread that procedure, but it has to do with opening these valves up until one at a time until the car starts to stall because it's getting too much fuel, and then you back it off a certain number of turns. But I got to reread that and review that because I don't remember. So that's all I have for today. Hopefully the next video I will be replacing the old carburetor with this one and getting it hooked up and adjusted. So hopefully I will see you then. Thanks for watching.